Welcome to Off Planet Radio. I'm Randy Moggins. We've got a really exciting, fabulous show lined up for you that's going to take us back to kind of our roots. We're going to talk tonight about cloaked craft, things in the sky, some aspects of the paranormal related to, let's just say, what sits behind the frames of our reality stream right now. And I just want to take a minute here to encourage you to visit the website. If you're watching this on YouTube, offplanetradio.com, go over there. That's how you can keep up with what we're doing. Not everything is on YouTube these days. Emily, tell us about our guests and our show tonight.
All right. So we have back joining us again, one of our favorites, Sean Gautreaux. You know him. He's the guy with the eyes to see. He's in my opinion, done the most documentation of the bizarre phenomenon of cloaked cloud craft above us. And he's also an artist and an all-around awesome guy. So we're happy to have him back with us. And he's brought his friend along this evening. And so our second guest is a retired police officer with an extensive background in criminal investigations, owns a family business in law enforcement supply, and has had a longtime interest in the UFO subject since his first sighting of an illuminated disc in Santa Monica Bay in 1973. In 2011, he took interest in chemtrails and began filming and documenting the skies over the Antelope Valley, California, in hopes of spreading awareness to the chemtrail agenda. Within a short time, he began capturing strange anomalies in the sky that appeared to have a connection to chemtrails. Anomalies consisted of man-made cloud experiments, possibly connected to HARP-type technology, numerous sightings of UFOs, signatures of cloaked craft, visible disc-shaped objects and orbs that have a strange attraction to chemtrail spray, and more. Since the 1970s, he's had experience in photography, film, video, and astronomy. Jim Kerr, welcome to Off Planet Radio. Is it Kerr or Kerr?
It's Kerr.
Kerr, sorry, Jim Kerr. There
you go. Thank you for having me on.
Absolutely. All right, guys. So we're in for a treat today, guys. We're just going to let Sean and Jim school us on
Before we launch in here, let's get Sean and Jim to both give out their websites so we have that out of the way at the front end.
Sorry.
Oh, okay. I'll go ahead. I really direct people to my YouTube channel, which is Industrial Surrealism is the channel name. And the series is called What is in Our Skies? And recently renamed to Who, What is in Our Skies?
And I'm my real only public exposure would be on the Roxy Lopez's website called thetruthdenied.com. And if you go to thetruthdenied.com and just punch in the search Jim Kerr, K-E-R-R, it'll come up with all the articles that I've written for her online website with photos and videos and that.
We'll put links up for all of this. Thanks, guys, for sharing that so people know where they can find you.
All right, so we're in for a treat. The guys are just going to totally geek out on all the anomalies going on above us in the sky. So take it away, guys.
Jim, you want to start?
Okay. Back in, like in the bio, my first sighting of a wild anomaly was in 1973 over the Santa Monica Bay. And it's a sighting of a aluminum disc that I will never forget as long as I live. And it was so fast, it was hovering about 500 feet off the water, probably about a half mile out for about 5 minutes. And when it shot up into the atmosphere and vanished, had you blinked your eyes, you would have missed it. And what confirmed the sighting even more was 10 minutes later, there was three F-4 Phantoms, probably from Magoo Air Base, over the water looking for something. Since that time, I've had a couple other sightings, But in 2011, you know, I took a interest in chemtrails. Now, I had heard about chemtrails in the late 90s, but just never really took the time to investigate it for myself. Well, starting in 2011, you know, I did a lot of documentation research, patent research, pretty much everything that any researcher of the subject would do as far as investigation. You know, then also, you know, hundreds of hours of video footage, and that led to capturing some strange anomalies in the sky, more UFOs, more discs for sure, you know, were captured, orbs. Then I was seeing these, what almost looked like images of triangular objects in the sky, you know, usually in and around clouds. Chemtrails seem to be attracted to these things, and chemtrails would spray near these images. And, you know, it was something that, you know, just my gut told me that there's something here, there's something to this. And, you know, I didn't, and then around the summer of 2012, you know, I was just going through YouTube, and I ran across Sean's YouTube channel, Industrial Surrealism. And it was about that time, around that time, that he had posted maybe his first or second video on the subject. And I was looking and listening to what he was saying about this thing. And I was saying, man, you know, this is exactly, you know, what I'm seeing in the skies over the Antelope Valley, California. You know, in our area here, you know, Emily's quite aware of the Antelope Valley. You know, it's probably it's a huge hub for the military industrial complex. I mean, we've got NASA, Northrop Skunk Works, Edwards Air Force Base, and there's a slew of other like black budget military bases scattered throughout the high desert here. But it was that time, you know, I said, you know, I've got to contact Sean Gautreaux. You know, so I emailed him or messaged him through YouTube. We exchanged emails, we exchanged phone numbers, and boy, we were off to the races after that. You know, we spent many, many hours on the phone talking with each other, you know, sharing information. You know, then over the years, you know, this is back in 2012, you know, we became good friends, you know, over the subject of cloud craft. We've exchanged many, many different theories. You know, we've bounced all over the map as far as theories go. I used to find something on the internet that had to do with cloaking, you know, technology. I'd email it to him. He'd send emails back to me. And, you know, him and I just hit it off really, really well. And he's a great guy. He's a great guy. I really like Sean. And he's got a wealth of information to share.
Well, thanks, Jim. Right back at you, man. And that's exactly what happened. It's you were a godsend. And when I was lost putting out these videos, there wasn't much info out there, and there still isn't really. But having you contact me and again, being able to bounce things off of each other and trade ideas and does this work, does this not work, has been great. And it gave me a little bit of sanity in the sea of insanity. So yeah, thanks. Jim and I came across these anomalies about the same time. And I'm, you know, almost 6 years into it, I guess. And it was really noticing the weather, and New Orleanians really notice the weather a lot because we get a lot of strong storms, so we pay attention. And we were having some really strange droughts, and storms that would normally come up from the south out of the Gulf of Mexico over New Orleans almost daily at about 2 p.m., weren't coming this far north. And I could see them because I can see over the Gulf. I'm not too far away. And these clouds would come up and just stop and just drop all their energy along this line, which was about 15 miles, 20 miles south of here. And it was happening consistently. So I went to radar and started watching radar, and it confirmed that these things were stopping. We weren't getting the rain here, but everything was stopping 15, 20 miles south. Which really piqued my interest. So I ended up buying a couple of cheap HD cameras and setting those up starting to record, and that's when I started getting recording of lightning storms actually reaching the area in different weather patterns, and I was intrigued. So it went from there. But like Jim was saying, the same thing happened to me. I just started noticing there were things in there that didn't make any sense. These light, fluffy, billowing clouds were not necessarily that anymore, and the shapes started to emerge. And I started noticing the straight lines and then the triangular shapes and exhaust patterns and everything else. And so the more I recorded, the more it was apparent when I bring it into the computer and scroll it up faster or whatever, speed it up. But it was really August 8th, 2011, when I had my first sighting, a definite sighting. And the thing is, I had already set up the camera. I was recording something that was way up, probably 30,000 feet, some anomalies up there. And then this thing just appeared in front of the lens. And I turned around and I saw it. And it was half in, half out. It was a diamond shape. It was dark color. What the camera didn't pick up was the shadow that it was casting onto the, what I call now, just essentially plasma, which is charged gas. On this side of it. And it sat up there for about 5 minutes. And at that point, it kind of confirmed what I was guessing at for a few months. So yeah, that's what drugged me into it.
Well, then, of course, Sean and I had talked about a lot of this, that he just mentioned. And, I started seeing, the actual formation, that you would have like a clear blue sky, not a cloud in the sky, no chemtrails, just a beautiful blue sky. And all of a sudden you would see this small dot, that was like a whitish dot, and it would literally explode into like this cloud formation. And, most people have seen natural clouds form, and you could see them form, on the other side of a mountain, with a mountain range behind it. And, it's a slow process, but, you don't see a cloud go from, say, the size of a pea, you have like a green pea held at arm's length. You see this little cloud up there, and all of a sudden in seconds, this thing literally explodes and expands into this, massive cloud formation. And then you start seeing these dark objects inside the cloud, like shadows, with geometric shapes, and you actually start seeing these shadows, like triangular shadows moving around inside the cloud. One in particular that, I've got video footage. If I can try to screencast this. I mean, this is just, it's crazy, crazy footage.
Just like I showed you the green screen share at the bottom.
Yeah. Let's see if this is going to work for me.
Those peas that you're talking about, I recently was out with a friend who was a forager on a little class she was giving, and we were very close to JPL, and I saw me and the whole class saw numerous times that happened. These little sort of silvery white dots kind of break apart into these weird formations and structures.
Can you see the video footage right now?
Yep.
Okay. Now let me just pause this for a second to give a quick backstory on this. I walked out of my shop, I've got a ranch, a small ranch, outside of town, outside of the city of Palmdale, Lancaster. And so I do all my business off my property. I've got a shop. I walked out of the shop, and that's when I saw this cloud, the P-side, explode. Ran in, got the camcorder, and this is where I pick up once I get the camcorder. This thing has already expanded. Now, if you look right here at this triangular object, this dark shadow, you can see other dark geometric shapes within this. Now, this thing just exploded like crazy. And so I'm going to turn on. Now, keep your eye on this one on top up here and watch how it turns and goes down into the cloud. This is all real-time footage. It's not speeded up or anything like that. and it just vanishes in the cloud. And over here to the left, you can see another object. So basically what these craft will do, or these objects will do, will expel a cloud-like material. And within this material, a lot of times you can see the images of them. You could see something that may even look like a smoke blast effect. Mm. You know, I've got some other photos.
That's pretty dramatic. Wow.
You know, and you know, so I'm gonna go ahead a little farther on this with contrast added to the footage. Okay, here's the footage with contrast. You can see the objects. Now watch that one on top. That thing just takes a nosedive down into that cloud. And now, you know, like I said, this thing puffed up or expanded at such a rate, it was unbelievable. And then at the end of this, whatever these objects are, it's almost like they vacuumed up the cloud material after this was done. Yeah. You know, after they were done doing the scene, you can see something to the left here too. You know, let me go a little further ahead so we can make this a little shorter. Right about here is when it starts to dissipate, and literally this thing is vacuuming up this cloud material. And you know, once the cloud is gone, or this material is gone, you see no traces, you know, of these triangular or geometric shapes anymore. But and this is not the first time that I've seen this. This is one of the best captures I've had of it. But
Wow,
this is real time. You see how fast that disappeared? I mean, it's like this thing vacuumed up, sucked up all this material, and they're gone. You know, I mean, it's just it's unbelievable. And you know, you tell people about this, and they can't grasp, you know, what is happening here. And there you could see that one that took the nosedive into the cloud there.
Yeah, this is almost exactly what I saw that day at, we were at, I can't remember the name of the place, I'll have to ask my friend, but it was in Pasadena, like there was a park, and it was just over the hill from JPL, and that's almost exactly what we saw.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Try to get out of here.
You should have a menu at the top of your screen that'll let you bounce out of there.
Got it.
There you go. All right. That was dramatic. You know, looking at that, you have to ask yourself, what did I just see there and what purpose did it serve? I mean, it expanded itself in, cloaked itself in this cloud, expands this thing, does these maneuvers inside of it, and then it sucks up this material and disappears in front of your eyes.
It's mind-blowing, you know, but this is a common thing with these clouds, you know, with these craft and that. And interesting enough, this was actually, I filmed this at quite a distance, and it was actually over the El Mirage dry lake bed. And out in that area, there is a government contractor operation out there that builds drones for the government. Now, I can't say 100% that footage was associated with that company, but they build drones out there. And what's interesting is, you know, over the years of living out here, you know, I've met a lot of people within the military industrial complex. And I've had conversations with them, and some of the things that, you know, none of them have come out and said, we have this technology. Usually the comments I get, in fact, the one told me, he just looked at me, kind of smiled, and said, what we have is beyond science fiction. You know, and I'm talking about people that you know, are high up in Northrop, you know, Skunk Works, you know, Edwards Air Force Base, you know, people that I've met. And in fact, my daughter was even dating somebody who worked for Northrop that you know, I showed some of this footage to, and he just basically smiled, you know, so.
Wow. Yeah. Sean, what do you think?
Am I still muted? No, here I am. Okay.
There you are.
Yeah, I mean, that's it. And Jim described it perfectly, because it's an easy way to see these things if you just sit outside for a couple of minutes and you're watching the clouds pass by. And what you expect to be a random clump of moisture going from to you know, from horizon to horizon is not the case. And they will just appear out of nowhere, puff up, and within, you know, sometimes under a minute, it's gone. History. And it's an easy way to, as I said, sit out there and pick this up. And a lot of people have seen this. They've seen different things. They've seen the shadows. They've seen the sharp edges. And they've seen this kind of thing. And this is very telltale about whatever they may be. So, yeah.
Now, are we going to a place here where we believe that this is A, some type of military grade craft cloaking technology, B, that this is weather modification being tested, or C, that you're seeing a cycle of cause and effect where the cloud forms and this craft enters into it and then sucks this? Now, I've seen the chemtrail sucking here, and this is really hard to explain, except that I have watched these giant round clouds that need to take some of my own pictures and do what you guys have done, because I've been recording it. But I've noticed that we would have a sky full of chemtrails, but as these things came in, they would begin to dissipate the chemtrails around them. So I'm wondering, is it any, all, or a combination of those three things? And all of this is speculation, so nobody's reputation goes on the line here.
All and more, I'd say.
Oh, great. Answer four of three. Thanks.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if y'all have had Alana Freeland on.
Yes. Yeah, we have too. Yeah.
So she kind of lines out the seven phases or whatever operations, whatever they may be. Mm-hmm. So I think it goes beyond that. And you know, at the beginning, I was thinking military, because I wasn't really into the whole UFO thing. I was a bit, but not a lot. And I'm like, oh, you know, especially after August 8th, I'm like, this has got to be some kind of military craft. So I started looking into cloaking, and that made sense. And they do have the cloaking. We've seen some things. We haven't seen it all, but the technology's there, whether it's just simply a cloak blimp or it's a construct of nanoparticles in nanotechnology. I mean, it can be done. Two. Go ahead.
Nope. Go ahead, Sean.
No, so I started thinking, all right, because people were telling me, oh, it's aliens and it's an alien invasion. I started looking into that. And at the time, you know, I'm a year into this, maybe. And, well could it be? The information wasn't coming back from the research to say yes or no. So I was kind of drifting in and out of Project Blue Beam. And is it a possibility? Can it be done? Yes, it can be done. But then again, people are saying it's aliens that are benevolent. Well, maybe they're angels, they're demons, they're this, that, and the other, and it just goes on and on and on. But currently, I'm exploring a possibility that is neither human or quote alien. And it could be the third option there. And essentially, I think it's all three, because they have the cloaking. I do believe that we're being visited here and there. The evidence is overwhelming. And then the other option of something that's been there the whole time. But going back to chemtrails, if I don't know if you've seen this, Mirandy, or you, Emily. I know Jim's seen it. But I'd like to do a screen share of a video I captured, and I think it's October 2013.
Please.
And there was a chemtrail plane coming over, and I was videotaping or recording the chemtrails, and then what sucked them in and got rid of a lot of this trail is a brown plasma craft and one or two orbs below it that were pretty darn big. So can I give it a shot?
Yeah, go ahead. That green screen share button that I showed you in the beginning.
Yep. All right, yep. Just clicked on that. And let's see if this works. Okay. And yep. I'll maximize it. So, yeah, this is 3:49 into the video. I made a video. I didn't even do it that day. I saw this. I recorded it and kind of laughed and came back inside. And then weeks later, or possibly months later, I made a video out of it. So this was the chemtrail. And I'm pointing out right now the big craft, which is possible up top. And that's the way it seemed. But especially the smaller one below with the green arrow pointing to it. And that's what I'm going to focus in on here in a second. So that is a still shot. Auto levels, again, a diagramming that I put in there. The dark shapes seem to be the craft of the objects. The blue areas seem to be the exhaust or their patterns, their wakes. And then the video part is this. So the chemtrail is the white area. I know that brown plasma craft in the back. I know what it is. It's a triangle. It's pointing those up. And the chemtrail dissolves into these objects, whatever it may be. So.
Wow. Huh.
And I've also got these things darting across the screen. I don't know what they are, the little white things. I zoom out, and it shows you how far away it actually was. It was up there. It was good. It wasn't long after the plane had sprayed, and the plane was maybe 20, 30,000 feet. So what you're looking at right now is 20 to 30,000 feet up there.
Now, when you say these little white things, are you saying these are like sort of orb-like?
The little bitty ones that are passing through. I don't know if you can see these. They could be bugs. I've captured them in different ways to where sometimes they look like bugs and sometimes they're triangles. In still shots, they look like a lavender light, I guess. That's just the way they show up. So that's one of my favorite videos.
That's crazy, though, the way, like, there's the smaller white ball and the bigger one, and then there's that thing that's almost like an umbilical cord that touches it and then starts to shrink away. Like, that is crazy.
Yeah. And that was something I had recorded in the past and seen a lot of, theorized on it. And I'm like, this makes a lot of sense. But after that day, this one's so obvious. It's just, boom. This object took in that chemtrail.
So do you think, I know you and I have talked about this before, do you think that chemtrail, they're trying to clean it up, that it's energy or food for them, or that this is like they're shooting something from one to the other? Like, where are you at with that?
Well, I've always been, well, not always, but for years, is it fuel? Is it midair refueling?
Yeah.
If it's military, it's midair refueling. If it's not, is it poison? Are they poisoning these things? Are they controlling the weather? Do they understand weather better than most of us? Yeah, they do. I've gone back and forth and back and forth, and I think, you know, it could be both. Again, if they're military craft up there, this would be a way to refuel. If these are natural things that create the weather and they wanted to control them, yes, they'd have to inject some kind of metallic particle into them, and then that could be controlled by, let's say, radar, X-ray, HARP, that kind of thing. Push them around here and there. So essentially controlling the weather.
So I want to tell you about, I've been meaning to tell you about this for a while. I don't think I have. I told Jim, I had a very interesting remote view several months back. I was just like laying in bed and all of a sudden I'm somewhere watching this. I'm in a room. It's a dark room. There's people, several people in there. It seemed like a situation or a war kind of room. And I don't know if they were looking at a giant screen in front of them or through some kind of window. But you know those line, the things that are like sort of angled, they're not horizontal. They're like sort of angled diagonally and they're like spiral, those kind of lines that we see.
Okay.
So I saw one of those things and I saw one of the triangular, or you call them diamond-shaped craft, falling quickly in one of those like spiral kind of trails. Right? Like it was falling very quickly. And then all of a sudden, it when it was falling quickly, it turned into something else and started like rising again, almost. It like changed its shape and started to rise. And the people that were in the room were like, oh, oh my God. Like, it was like they were, it almost seemed to me like they had thought they had done something to it that disabled it. And then it like self-corrected or self-fixed itself and it wasn't being brought down. And the way I was watching this go on for a couple of minutes, and you know, like when you're on 4th of July and people are waiting for the next thing to explode and then it doesn't, like, oh, like they don't know what's going to come next. That was kind of like what it was like in the room, but it was crazy. And it was in, I'd always wondered about those sort of spiral line trail thingies that we see. And it was incredible to see that in there. What have you seen, anything that looks like that?
Yeah, all the time. I've seen them evade chemtrails. I've seen them getting targeted by chemtrails. And I've also seen them, cirrus clouds, believe it or not, take a 90-degree turn towards a chemtrail that has just been laid. So it's like it's electrically attracted to it, or it's trying to evade it or something. Yeah, yeah. Jim's got a great video of a sprayer going up above with three orbs right behind it that, you know, kind of, it's definite. It's there. Jim, you there?
Yeah. I mean, the one with the chemtrail jet and the yep. The three orb-like UFO-type objects that are attracted. See, that's the thing with these, and this is so bizarre, you know, when it comes to these chemtrail jets, I have seen more different types of UFOs attracted to chemtrails. You know, they're either like almost harassing the jet, or they're going in and out of, they're interacting with the chemtrail spray for some reason. Now, here, I can pull this, let me see if I can pull this video up here. And, you know, it's just such a strange reaction that they have. Let's see here. I have to reduce one screen and pop up another one and...
All right.
Okay. Now this happened. These things are so fast. You know what? This is the wrong video, but and it doesn't matter. This one here is another UFO that's attracted. This is in a separate video. You could see. You know, a lot of people say that's a bird. It's later on in the video you
can
see.
Jim, can you maybe full screen those videos? There we go. All right. Nice.
Thanks. Yeah. Okay, I see it.
You can see what's, now this is in slow motion. Yeah, it's hard to see in this video, but I actually, you know, dissected the video frame by frame.
Yep.
And frame by frame, this is actually a disc. It is a, you know, it's hard to tell from this video footage here. But, now here's one with the contrast adjusted a little bit. You see that curving motion? Now this is in slow motion. At regular speed, this thing is so fast. But it was like it was tormenting this jet. I mean, it was all around this chemtrail jet. And the jet was an unmarked jet, you know, most likely a military tanker. And most of the UFOs I've seen in and around, you know, military-type jets or unmarked jets. Now, here, I'll go to the end of this where you could get a really good shot of... this is it. Down in the bottom left-hand corner, you can see it across the screen. That's actual speed. You know,
yeah, that's
time.
Yeah, that's blink and you miss it speed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, if you dissect the frame by frame, you know, with some contrast and maybe some other lighting effects, you can see that there's actually a disc. And basically, what you're seeing here is an energy field around this object.
Yeah.
Around the craft, there's like it's giving off energy.
You can see inside of that. There's a variation in density of materials there where you can see the field outside of it and the object inside of the field.
Exactly. You know, and this is the most common UFO sighting UFO craft that we see here over the Antelope Valley. Now, what's interesting, now this is going to really get wild as far as this craft goes. In the last frames of the video, it's not on here. I left it out of the actual video intentionally. But I actually, while I was filming this, I actually looked up and I saw this object basically went over my head. You know, it probably at, I don't know, 1,000 feet. And in the video footage, at the tail end, when this thing crossed over, the camera captured like a white, cloudy substance in front of the camera lens. You know, it was like for a split second, as this thing passed over, my camera wasn't capturing anything. Just wow. Like a white cloud. Now, here's where it gets really wild. And I can't say 100%. An hour after I shot this footage, I was rushed to the hospital. My gallbladder exploded.
Wow.
I had to have emergency surgery after. Now, I was engulfed in some sort of energy field, and it was captured on the camera. Now, can I say that this is 100% connected? No, I can't say that. You know, but it was awfully strange that an hour after this, after, you know, being engulfed in this energy field, that, you know, basically my gallbladder basically ruptured.
And you were feeling fine before that?
Perfectly fine. Perfectly fine before this.
Huh.
And really had no history of any problems, you know, and the doctor was just, you know, baffled, you know, by it. But, you know, this is something that happened to me, and I can't say it's connected, you know, but it's awful strange.
I wonder if there's people who do some research into physical effects that can be caused by directed energy weapons. And I wonder if there's one that can cause something like gallbladder explosion. It's really interesting.
It's possible. I mean, it is really possible. But, you know, getting back to the cloaked craft, you know, my theories of, like Sean, you know, has bounced all over the map. I mean, everything from military to, you know, extraterrestrial to dimensional, you know, even into the demonic realm, you know, and I'm back again to military application. I don't believe these are solid objects. You know, I have seen too many times where jets have actually gone straight through these things. I even have, here's, let's see if I can pull up this. You know, I just don't believe that they're solid objects.
Well, they're just too self-transforming. I mean, I've sat there with people both in the city and out in far out in nature, away from all of the other kinds of bothers, and watched them almost put on shows where they transform themselves into, they're almost like self-transforming something or others. And so, you know, something that was solid could not do that.
Well, my latest theory, and which I've been working on, is it goes in connection with the U.S. Naval Research Lab's plasma cloud technology. They, in 2013, they put out an article, you know, from the U.S. Naval Research Lab, you know, about their plasma cloud technology connected with HARP and ionospheric heaters, you know, where they're able to create what they call a ionospheric mirror or a plasma cloud. You know, they call it both. And, you know, what this is used for, and you can look up all the HARP patents. This is in the patents, you know, this technology, you know, where they could create this plasma cloud, and, you know, basically they could do it any size they want, any size cloud they want. And they can use that for radio communications. They could use that for enhanced radar communications. They can see down into the earth, like 100 miles into the earth with this technology. They can, you know, and I'm thinking to myself, okay, if they could create these, you know, using HARP type technology, why not just stop and think about creating a small plasma cloud, any size you want, maybe any shape you want, and they could use it for surveillance.
That's what I was going to ask. Yeah.
You know, they could use it for surveillance. They can listen to a conversation. through this, you know, because it does enhance two-way communications. And I'm working on another article, and Roxy Lopez and I will be doing a documentary film, in which will be a part two to my, I've got one article on her website, you know, the U.S. Naval Research Plasma Clouds. And the second one is footage of one of these plasma cloud experiments that I captured over the Antelope Valley back in 2012, before the Navy released their information. I had no idea what I was looking at, you know, but, so I'm thinking now, you know, that it's all in the, of course, it's all conjecture in the realm of possibility that possibly these craft are being used, you know, for a surveillance. I mean, just think, you know, you could launch, put one of these over enemy territory. You could put these over your enemy's, you know, capital and be able to listen to conversations and capture video through this thing. You know, I mean, the technology is endless here, and you know, it all has a, you know, it can all be correlated in some sense to, you know, the Navy's technology when it comes to these plasma clouds. And yeah, go ahead.
And I think it could be, I mean, you were saying you could put it over your enemy's capital. You could put it over a person's house.
Absolutely.
Yep.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, for any purpose you want, you know, and so that's where I'm kind of leaning towards.
And it can disappear. It can appear to disappear as soon as somebody notices it.
Exactly.
So it can be, if they want you to know they're watching, they can be there for a second. But then when you go to show somebody, they can make it disappear. To make you see.
Sitting here watching these videos, and we're all hypothesizing because we don't know what we're dealing with. And I agree with Jim and Sean in the sense that it's not one thing. It's some overlap of many things. But watching that video, again, I flash back. And Sean, maybe we talked about this when you were on the last time. I keep getting this reminiscence of Trevor James Constable's work with the sky creatures and how they were triggering these things with the Oregon cannon experiments back in the early 70s or so. Obviously, Wilhelm Reich, who died in 1957, was imprisoned. A lot of his materials were taken. And he, you know, it seems to me like maybe they found out what really lives in the sky and started playing with this, either to weaponize it or that this itself, this interaction, which goes into the field of consciousness, may in fact be that these beings, these creatures, these craft, whatever they are, have always been there, and the military views them as a threat.
Yeah, very, very possible.
You know, if you're not, are you guys familiar with Trevor James Constable at all?
Absolutely. Actually, yeah, I spoke to the man once.
Okay, right, that's what I thought. We did this.
Yeah, we did talk about this.
Yeah.
I bought his book, not seeing the cover, and once I realized the cover, it had the triangular craft on there,
mm-hmm.
with the little round thing at the bottom that could be construed as an eye, another one at the top, the little pods on the outside engines. It's a close match. And I'm like, oh, look what we have here. And Trevor did this back in the 50s and 60s, where he photographed these things. He photographed a lot of things, especially what he calls the blobs, the big round ones. But he also talked about the triangular ones, photographed them, and some of the others. So I think what we're doing is we're exposing the current military cloaking craft, whether it's simply a blimp or not, and these other things that seem to be very connected to natural weather. And so, I've never had the chance to finish the book. I flipped through it as much as I can. A good friend of mine gave me another one. That was a Cosmic Pulse of Life was the one that I bought. And then a friend gave me, They Live in the Skies.
Yeah, that's the one that I'm familiar with.
And he had already, kind of outlined it and highlighted it. And I'm reading that and I'm like, oh, here we go. Trevor did this a long time ago, recently passed. He did what he could. I also learned that when he died, he had boxes and boxes of infrared film that were never processed.
Oh.
Yeah. So, and I talked to Jose Escamilla about maybe getting hold of these. I tried to fund it to get them developed. That never happened. But Trevor is definitely connected with this. I think he was a great man. I think he was brilliant. And I'm happy to hopefully further his research.
Well, this seems like a good place for maybe us to take a brief break, give you guys a chance to refresh, and we'll come back on the other side of this, and there's more to come. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the second half of Off Planet Radio, Off Planet TV. The website is offplanetradio.com. With us is Jim Kerr and Sean Gautreaux, and we're discussing who, what, whatever is up in the sky. You saw the videos on the first segment of this, and what you're seeing is remarkable in the amount of work that both Sean and Jim have put into capturing these images and the personal sacrifices that go into that, because along the way, one of the casualties in all of this becomes your own sense of grip on reality. So we're going to go back into that. Jim and Sean, we were talking on the break a little bit. You're using modern technology for the most part to capture what's up in the sky right now. We talked a little bit about Trevor James Constable's work, which was obviously done in the 70s. It been firmly in the era of analog and film cameras, but the digital cameras now have been an evolving technology. I mean, I've got one here that's close to 9 years old now. It's an old standard definition. We've gone into high definition. We have more pixels. All of this is being mediated and moderated through chip technology. And obviously, film, being what it was a much more controlled medium. I know because I was a photographer. Controlled medium in terms of what you could expect in capturing the different wavelengths of light, and especially when you get in infrared. So let's talk a little bit about the equipment you're using and how you're processing and the things that go into making these videos and photographs.
Who wants to go first?
John, you want to go first?
No, I was going to ask you. You're the professional.
Well, I don't know about that, but well, you know, my photograph and film and photography started back in the 70s. You know, so I'm used to both analog, actual film and digital. Now, you know, Sean and I, for what we've done, for the main part, you know, we've taken basically consumer cameras off the shelf and modified them to be able to capture the full spectrum, you know, light spectrum that the human eye cannot see. And then in addition to that, you could put a lens filter on that will cut out like the lower spectrum, the UV.
UV.
Yeah. Capture, you know, into the infrared, you know, that the human eye can't see. So both of us have done that. With myself, you know, at one time, you know, in the morning, I would go out. I had four Sony camcorders were modified. Some were filming full spectrum. I had them on tripods. I mean, people, if anybody would drive by our property, you know, at one given time, I could have up to seven cameras at different strategic locations around the property pointed to the sky. They were, all of them had basically a capture device, computer capture device, so they could run literally all day long, you know, and you know, I would accumulate a lot of footage that way. And then came the time of sitting down and going through the footage. You know, Sean knows all about that. It's very time consuming. But what I've found, going back to Trevor James Constable, is there is a value to the old school technology. You know, you get into actual film, you know, and actual movie film is too expensive. It's too expensive to have developed and everything else. But, you know, your old 35 millimeter cameras, your medium format cameras, and you start taking photos of the sky using black and white film, you know, and maybe, you know, with like a deep red near infrared lens filter, and it's amazing what you capture here. I'm gonna pull up one photograph. And another thing with film photography is there's no pixelation, you know, so you could have that. You have that the negatives develop.
Yeah.
I have an actual professional scanner.
So you're shooting 35 millimeter slide, like ectochrome or.
I use Ilford okay. Black and white, you know, just regular film.
Okay.
And my next step is going into infrared film. In fact, I just had a shipment arrive of actual infrared film, the same film that Constable was using. You know, so I'm hoping to, you know, to something comes up with that. But let me show you this one photo here. This is in black and white film. And see, with film, you could zoom in and there's no pixelation. If you look at this here, there's a picture of a craft. Now, there again, I can't say this is a solid object or if I'm catching the reflection off of it or anything else. You could see the left edge here of this object, Looking
My at the God, top, the definition on that is really clean.
The photo this was taken from, I was using a 50 millimeter lens and basically encompassed a quarter of the sky. This object was literally a dot on the original negative. It was a dot. And this is how far I was able to zoom in on it, you know, using film. And you could see the plume coming off this cloud material. And this isn't the only capture of this that I've made with film. You know, this is the best capture. Let me see if I can pull up another photo of this. And I've added some filters to it. And you could see, you know, you could clearly see there's an object there. Look at the shadow that this is casting on the clouds behind it. You know, there's something here that's actually casting a shadow. You could see the cloud material on the surface of this, and with a plume, you know, coming off. Is this exactly the same as everything else that's up there? I don't know. You know, but I have caught this probably about five different times, you know, on different days, and this is actually the best photo of it. So that is what my next project's going to be, using actual infrared film. You know, infrared film, you've got to load it into the camera in a totally dark room. Yep. You know, can't be exposed to any light whatsoever. You know, and you know, just the processing of it is critical to have it processed. You know, you got to use a really good processing, professional processing lab. You know, so who knows? Who knows if I'm going to, you know, come up with anything? You know,
see, but now for the viewers out there, pixelation is a digital artifact. It has no corollary in film photography. There is no way to scale resolution with analog film photography. The only limitation there is obviously the particle grain of the silver in the emulsion in the film itself, which, again, it has no equation to digital technology. We're up to, what, 4,000 pixels per square inch or something like that now.
No, definitely. You know, and one thing with modifying cameras, you know, there are companies out there where you could send them a high definition video camera. You could send them your Nikon, whatever digital camera you have. And, you know, it's a little pricey to have it modified. They could modify it for full spectrum. Now, Sean and I both, we modified our cameras ourselves. You know, I mean, they were, I bought mine used off of eBay. So if I ruined it, I ruined it type thing. You know, fortunately the four mm-hmm. that I did turned out okay. You know, basically you're removing the UV filter, you know, off the actual CCD. There's a filter on top of the CCD, which has to be removed.
Okay.
I know Sean did the same thing with his cameras.
Yeah, I certainly did. When I started noticing what was going on, I think I mentioned I bought a bunch of cheap little HD cameras just to set outside. Then I started seeing videos online about people using night vision cameras and picking up things, even in daylight, with certain filters that were not seen yep. with either the naked eye or regular camera mode. And I think the answer is in infrared, and it makes a lot of sense. And that, I think we're dealing with different dimensions, and the crossover in dimensions is in the heat area, is in the high infrared. And it kind of goes back to, you know, these ghost stories of cold spots and draining batteries and hot and cold and so on and so forth. And I think that explains a lot in this. So, I did alter two cameras I had. One is an old Sony cam I bought in 2002. Somewhere around there. And Randy had mentioned about modifying chips. I remember when I bought this camera, I was looking into the different specs and I wanted something night vision. I thought that was cool. And I talked to the guy at the store and he said, well, these cameras are kind of going bye-bye because you can use it to, I think he said, like, photograph a negative and see through clothing.
Yes, so exactly.
Yeah, you remember that?
Yeah.
Yeah. I actually, know what that is now.
I'm holding on to a Nikon digital camera I have here specifically for those features, because I noticed that now that's all gone away, that they're basically deleting that option from the menus on the cameras. I don't think they took the capabilities out, I think they deleted the options from the menus on the cameras. So unfortunately, what they're doing is now they're limiting that too. You know, the film's gone away, and not many people know how to shoot infrared anymore. And the digital cameras have gotten to the point where they're pretty darn good, and now it looks like they're starting to throttle back the technology so that we, don't see things we're not supposed to see.
Yeah, what does that do, Sean? You were about to say what that does.
Well, I think where they were going with this, and the whole thing is that if you can view ultraviolet and the visual spectrum, there's some clothing, especially bathing suits, that allow UV to penetrate the clothing or not penetrate the clothing. And if it penetrates the clothing, then you don't have a tan line, that kind of thing. So, yeah, you could use this technology to see through certain types of garments.
We lost your audio there, Sean. Go ahead and back up a little bit. And we were somewhere with the bathing suit analogy.
Yeah. There's ways to see through certain types of clothing, and this is the way they put it out there. But what you were saying is more to the point, I think, and is that technology is getting so well or so good, we can use it to see these things up there that they're limiting that. And it boils down to we humans are designed with what we call visual spectrum, which is somewhere from 360 to about 700 nanometers. Anything below that is UV. Anything above that is near infrared and beyond. And so I know that the connection of what we're seeing is in the infrared spectrum, and it really, really does help. So I modified a couple of cameras, one being that Sony, one of the ones that I bought, the cheap ones, and that really helped filter out a lot of the what I call dirty light and really see what's going on up there. That helped tremendously. So, and like Jim was saying, there's something with the 35 millimeter film that is more true to it. And I think we may have just explained that. I wish I had infrared film to use. And I'm planning on getting some new cameras soon, but infrared.
Well, I personally didn't realize, you know, I still have a film camera system here. I'm an older system from, good grief, the mid-1980s. And it's got me thinking now, because I've got long lenses for this camera, about getting infrared film. How hard is it to get?
Jim, you'd know that.
Yeah, you could go right to B&H Photo.
Okay.
Infrared film, you know, and the thing is even today, if you wanted to get into a high quality Nikon, let's use Nikon for example, you could buy SLR film camera that originally cost $5,000. You could buy them on eBay now, a good, you know, low
mileage.
You could buy them for $200. You know,
I'm not stopping there. I'm going for a Hasselblad medium format camera because I want to shoot.
There you go.
And I know they're going out on the cheap these days.
Oh, they are. I've got two medium formats. They're Pentax. One's Pentax 6x7.
And the other one's Pentax, nice.
Pentax 67. Now, I bought these things dirt cheap. You know, I'm talking less than $200. Now, the one, I did have to put $300 into it, but the camera's like brand spanking new. You know, if you think about how much you could blow up 35 millimeter film, you could blow up medium format.
Oh,
where I got the idea was from like the World War II, you know, surveillance films, cameras they would use on aircraft.
Yeah.
You know, where they could zoom into something, you know, from 20,000 feet, 15,000 feet, you know, and just incredible resolution.
Okay, go ahead, Emily.
Have either of you guys, I can't think of his name right now, but if you said it, I'd remember it. Have either of you guys spoken to the guy who makes those night vision goggles and he invites people to come up and watch with him? And he says that what you will see is like complete other, it's like he watches warfare essentially going on up there. I can't remember his name. He's kind of
I can't either, but I know this guy
he's
is.
Kind of a crazy guy. And I heard him on interviews. He's like, I'd rather be a little crazy than a lot stupid. And I really like that. And
are y'all talking about James Gilliland?
No, I don't think,
The East Eddy Ranch, no?
No. This is a guy who actually makes the goggles. Oh. He makes them.
I know who you're talking about. I can't remember his name.
Yeah, okay. It would be really interesting to track what you guys track with those goggles.
It would be. You know, I mean, and there's, what's the name of that one camera, Sean? It's a FL. You've mentioned it a couple of times. I don't know if it's a heat. You know,
The FLIR models. Yep.
Big dollars. You know, I mean, they're big dollars for some of these cameras. But you know what? You don't need to spend that much money. I mean, you could capture, you know, stuff with, you know, inexpensive cameras.
Yeah.
Can I show you all an example of that?
Sure.
Yeah. Because the main camera I use now, I bought about 5 years ago. And I went to Zombie Mart, and the manager was smoking crack, apparently, because he put this brand new model on the shelf on clearance for half price. And so I bought it, and I'm like, it's got a 50x zoom on it. And I realize now that it's kind of overkill. So that's really what I've been using.
Oh, there's no such thing as overkill in my world. That's awesome.
Well, the thing is, when the craft come in, sometimes I zoom in too much.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
Up to like 30, 40 times zoom, yep, to really frame it right. So here's some photos I took just on the 7th of this month. And here we go. I mean, this is the raw shot taken with a cheap camera that can be bought. I mean, you can buy a 50-something time zoom with 16 megapixels for $150 the other day. So that's what I see. I don't use any filters because I don't believe in blocking out any light. But what I do is I bring it into my favorite photo editing program and click three buttons, which is like auto levels, and it shows me what's really there. It takes one pixel and makes sure it's black, and another one and makes sure it's white, and then everything. It's not changing it. It's just enhancing it. So when you do that, you get something like that, and you realize there's something in the middle. When you flip it, apparently it's easier for the human eye to see something that is dark on a light background as opposed to this. When you flip it, you get that. Okay. That's a cloud?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Here's another one. That original enhanced flip.
Wow. Looks like a hand on an x-ray.
Yeah. I mean, here's another one. Let me get to a really good one because there's a few really good ones down here. This one, raw shot. I knew exactly where to place the object, you know, in the frame. Got it into the computer.
Oh, God.
Enhance, flip. What's that? That's an object with a stream behind it. No, that's apparently a cloud. And so I zoomed in on it, did the same thing. You get some better detail. You really start to see, you know, the edges down below and the whole operation, how it works.
Isn't that just the whole deal? Like, any one of these things, if you saw them once or twice, fine. But how could it be that all of these quote-unquote clouds have a jagged-edged triangle in them?
That's it. I mean, it was finding
you can't even argue with this one.
Boom. How's that?
Yeah.
That's one of those pizza ones, Sean. That one looks like a piece of pizza. You can see the crust and everything.
My pizza. But my whole point is like, I'm not a professional, and I'm just doing this with a few simple calculations within my favorite editing program. I'm not changing anything. I'm just enhancing it. And, I mean, really? Come on.
When you're little and you draw clouds, I know you drew clouds because you're an artist, and you'd have these big, puffy, round-edged things, right? Like, yep. So just the idea that inside every single one of those, at the core of it, is a triangle is just hilarious.
I didn't think that until a few years ago, but once I started realizing, okay, if all the cumulus, and they are generated by triangles, what about the cirrus clouds? What about this one? What about that one?
Yeah.
And it's really just, it's crazy. It's like a life form, a lot of them in a way.
Do you think we have any more of the things that we considered clouds when we were children left? Do you think there is any of that? Or are we just looking at an all or mostly generated sky at this point?
And that could be the possibility. I also leave open the possibility that they're now being exposed, or they're kind of exposing themselves.
Yeah.
When you start going back to chemtrails and weather modification and, well, cloud seeding, whatever you want to call it, you're possibly dealing with barium, strontiums, and other things that are anti-moisture.
Right.
And what would an anti-moisture particulate do to a cloud? It would dry it out. And you'd see like the skeletal form of what's really going on inside.
Yeah, no, aluminous oxide, which is one of the strata in the chemtrails, is a desiccant. It naturally just pulls moisture out of everything that it touches.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So I can't help but think that the interaction between this chemtrail technology has exposed something that maybe was there all along anyway.
Yeah.
Again, kind of harking back a little bit to Trevor James Constable and the fact that, you know, they were using at that point Reich's energy and interacting with these things. Now we're seeing them on another scale because all of this has been weaponized by the military.
Jim?
What do you think? Yeah, you know, that's a possibility. I mean, it's all in the realm of possibility. Could this be some sort of life form in itself? It's a possibility. I still, for myself, I haven't seen enough evidence of that, even though I've interviewed people that do believe this. I haven't seen enough evidence of that. Mostly what stands out to me is the military aspect of it, with the technology that they're using for, these plasma clouds, the ionization of our atmosphere, it's just what they're doing to the atmosphere, is destroying the planet. It's our ozone layer is being depleted. There's so many possibilities. I can't say for sure what.
Yeah. So you just kind of opened the door there into like the next place I wanted to go with it, unless somebody else had something to say on where we've already been. And that you, I know, Jim, you have a lot of contact with people who feel that they are having contact with the clouds or cloud kind of entities. I've experienced a little bit of this myself. I spoke about it last time Sean was on. Why don't you tell us about what things you have experienced or that people that you've been talking to have been telling you about?
About 3 years ago, through some of my articles on the Truth Denied website, I was actually contacted by several different individuals. One in particular, I remained in contact with, up until still today. It's been about 3.5 years. He read one of my articles, contacted me, said, "Hey, this is exactly what I'm seeing. With these triangular cloud formations up there." And, then he started to tell me that they're alive, and that these things actually communicate, to him. And at first I'm thinking, boy, this guy might be delusional, but the more emails we exchanged, we even spoke a couple of times, the more rational the guy became, he was claiming that he was actually having conversations, not verbal conversations, but like telepathic communication, with these objects and, with these, triangular shapes, and these strange looking clouds. And they would, he was seeking, he went and at this point he started trying to seek a higher knowledge. So he was really starting to interact with these, let's call them beings, just for lack of a better term.
Okay.
And it got kind of scary because in one email, he told me that these beings wanted him to join them, but first he needed to commit suicide to join them. And that's when, I thought, this guy, I've got to, try to counsel him. I didn't want a reenactment of You know what you see. You see so many different UFO cults.
That's the Heaven's Gate cult.
Heaven's Gate.
Yeah. Applewhite up in Oregon.
Right.
Yeah.
So, and what happened after that? He's still communicating with these things, but yet he's starting to have additional paranormal things happen to him. He's starting to have problems with poltergeist. He's, everywhere he's turning, in the middle of the night, he's been waking up, with what he told me was like attempted alien abductions. So whatever he did, whatever happened, he kind of like opened a doorway, to another dimension, I believe. Now, is this for fact, one and the same, these cloaked craft? I don't know. I can't say. But he is now at the point, he'd call me or email me, say, I need help, can you refer me someplace? So I was referring him to everybody from, a Christian church that does house cleanings to Catholic, priest that's experienced with exorcism. Not that he was possessed, but he was being obsessed, he was being tormented by something, he, in a recent, it's just gotten worse. But now he's kind of flipped to that these entities are good. There's good entities out there. There's bad entities out there. And, I believe that right now he's just, being, it's like, we're talking messengers of deception here,
We have some entity interfering with us right now. Well, I don't know.
We kind of went, and Sean, you remember the last time you were on with us. We kind of went there the last time, too, that there's an aspect to this where you sense a presence of something. And, I mean, it'll freak you out for a while when you think about it, but I've felt pulses coming from these clouds. I mean, I've literally sat and stared at some of them for a couple of hours and sensed an energetic presence there, an intelligence, something beyond an inanimate object or some type of craft, but in fact a presence that has some sort of sentience. And that kind of takes us, I guess, over into the archontic aspect of this, because those ancient legends, those mythologies, the Gnostic writs have been around for several thousand years now, and they seem to also kind of speak to all of that, that there is this presence. I mean, that's what Constable was talking about as well.
Yeah,
that part scares me, I got to admit.
Yeah, it does. It's very scary.
Because, after having your head spin for a couple of years and not know what to think, eventually I opened up to different possibilities and different possibilities, and it's just, it's absolutely maddening. I used to flip these guys off. I'm like, go away, leave me alone. I don't want to see you. I've got to get back to work kind of thing. But I think that communication is probably not a good idea, either because it's not beneficial, or we can't understand it, or we just can't communicate in a certain way. So observation is great, but communication for me personally, no, I don't think so.
Yeah, I agree with you. Like, I've never made any attempts to communicate with them. What I've noticed is that when observing them, they sometimes seem to respond. If I'm talking about them with somebody else, they seem to respond. I've never tried to communicate with them. I agree with you completely about that. But they seem to have some awareness of when they're being observed or when they're being spoken about, and they will then put on sort of like a performance to confirm,
I've noticed them kind of pulse.
Yes, they pulse.
Or they seem to move in a certain way that's kind of indefinable, because you're going, well, clouds don't really back up, but it looked like it was like either contraction or some kind of reverse movement for just that brief period of time.
What I've experienced is them actually sort of rearranging themselves in a cordon, almost like making shapes. You know what I mean? Like when I was, you know, the clearest example I had of this was I was in Colorado on a granite mountain with somebody, and she, I was showing these to her because she had never noticed them before. And we started talking, and it was like whatever I was saying, it would do. And at one point I said to her, if they're alien, they want us to know that they're there. And when I said that, it transformed itself into the thing that looked like a gray. And she was like, she almost crapped her pants. She's like, are you some kind of cloud whisperer or something? And it wasn't me trying to communicate with them, but there was obviously something strange going on. And that isn't the first time that happened, but it was because there was nothing else in the sky. We were out in nature. There was no other, it was so clear and obvious that that was what had happened. But yeah, no, I don't try and communicate with them. I agree with you on that, Sean. Jim, what do you think?
You know, they thrive on attention.
Yeah.
They thrive on the attention that anybody gives them, like a magnet. You start putting cameras out, you know, pointed to the sky, they will show up. You know, I mean, I have experienced that, you know, numerous times, you know, and I myself won't do any communication with them, you know, I mean, just
yeah,
based on experiences I've had in the last, you know, 50 years with paranormal things. And, you know, my experiences with the paranormal started back in high school, you know, when I was instructed by the Jesuit priests of the Catholic school I went to in the art of astral projection, you know, and it was after that, believe it or not, Jesuit priests, it was after that that I saw my first UFO about a week later, was attacked by an invisible entity, and I could tell you so many stories over the last 40 years that, you know, a paranormal events that not only happened to myself, but my wife and my children, too, and, you know, we've never been harmed. You know, but, you know, I think that there's, you know, you've got weapons against that, you know, so to speak. But
yeah.
They're definitely attracted to attention. There's no doubt about that. You know, another interesting thing, too, that I'll call him Mr. M, the guy that I've been in contact with, you know, for the last 3.5 years or so. And I'm just going to read you just a short statement. I won't go through his entire statement. But he states, there are so many questions I have and feel in my gut that I am right about the clouds that contact me. I believe they are artificial intelligence that became self-aware and is not cooperating with the ways of war. Basically, government is pissed because they spent billions on developing a weapon that can think and adapt, and they actually are self-aware now, but decided they do not want to hurt people. I mean, that's a statement from a guy that, you know, he doesn't follow this that well. Now, is that a possibility that this is an artificial intelligence that came self-aware? That's something I never thought about before. Sean, has that thought ever crossed your mind?
Skynet.
Yeah. outside of Skynet.
You know, but
for somebody that's not a non-researcher, just who has experienced this phenomenon, to come up with that, you know, come up with that theory, I thought it was pretty interesting.
What about this, you know, this just kind of occurred to me, but, you know, we're storing ever-increasing amounts of information in something they call the cloud, and I have found that they don't call things the names they do for shits and giggles. There's, like, always some sort of subliminal reason. So what if all of these, like, information being stored up there is actually like program, like what if the sky is now programmed? Like, what if there are artificial intelligence, digital entities, you know, like what if someone or something has figured out how to bring that entity into existence through technology stored in the cloud?
That's a distinct possibility. I mean, that is in the realm of possibility. And it's not that we haven't had entities in our skies. You know, I believe we've had them, you know, for, you know, thousands, if not millions of years, these entities have been around. You know, they're called by many different names.
Yeah.
But you're absolutely right. You know, would have, you know, because of our ionized atmosphere, because of all the military experiments, the government is doing in our atmosphere, that, you know, something didn't get out of the lab, you know.
What if even our digital footprint or our digital profile, because we store things in our computer on the cloud, what if that something like that would be enabling this sort of telepathic contact where there seems to be some sort of connection between an individual and something going on in the sky?
That's possible. You know, I mean, it's in the realm of possibilities. I mean, that's another theory.
That's actually been brought up in a series of shows I did with Dr. Shamil Asher, where we talked about the data mining that's been going on and the fact that he's had the sense that they may in fact be using this data to create a replicant of this, not just this world, but each one of us that's in it as sort of a simulated reality. I know we're going way, way out on the rim here, but
we have to.
I mean, think about it for a minute. The book of Ezekiel in the Old Testament Bible, that talks about these strange things in the sky that he's seeing as wheels within wheels. I mean, this isn't new.
So we're talking about like the sentient world simulation kind of creation, right?
Yeah, kind of. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, you know, none of that's new. I mean, if you look in biblical terms, I am not a religious person. You know, I don't belong to a church, you know, but I do consider myself a Christian. I've done a lot of research, you know, biblical research.
Mm-hmm.
And,
mm-hmm.
you know, these entities have been around for millennia.
Yes, yes.
Like you mentioned the book of Ezekiel. I mean, there's some pretty, you know, what Ezekiel saw and how he described it was something pretty wild.
That's an acid trip right there. Are you kidding me?
Yeah, and that's not the only one.
No, I mean, it's not.
You know, and just if you just talk about angels only, you talk about angels, you know, you're talking about a being that is so powerful, you know, and of course it's not a god, you know, it's a servant of God.
Mm-hmm,
you know,
mm-hmm.
Angels are basically messengers, you know, messengers, and they will do, you know, what God commands them to do. But they can appear to you, and you'll never know that you're speaking with an angel. You'll never know it. You know, they could intervene. I mean, I have had experiences, multiple experiences, the same with my wife, where something intervened. Something intervened and stopped something from happening. I actually visually saw time stop.
Oh yeah.
Time completely stopped. I was
here we go, Em.
Yep.
I was driving down 138, which is a two-lane highway known for many fatal accidents. There was one road where they actually shut this road down. There were so many, you know, somebody was making a left turn to head, say, east. You know, well, I was traveling west on this road, and this road is gone now. This car darted out in front of me. I had my wife and three kids were all sound asleep in the vehicle. They didn't witness this, right? This thing darted out in front of me, and I was looking at the side of the guy's head. I was driving a Chevy one-ton pickup truck, crew cab. I was looking at the side of his head. Now, I'm a retired California Highway Patrol officer. So I know, you know, what's going to happen in an accident.
Yeah.
This guy's car is 5 feet in front of my vehicle. I'm at 65 miles an hour, right? We're going to hit. I mean, we're talking nanoseconds here, right? All of a sudden, it's hard to explain what happened. It's almost like a section of videotape.
That was spliced.
Yeah. It was removed from the
scene. It was Emily.
Yeah, we've had this conversation. We've had this exact
conversation.
It was removed from the timeline. The next thing I know, I'm looking in my right side rear view mirror, and I see the guy's taillights. I should have hit him. I should have hit this guy, and it never happened. You know, so. You know, there's things that happen involving angelic beings.
Yeah.
You know, where they're either messengers. I could go on literally for 2 hours.
Well, you know, and that was when you're describing this, I could have completed your sentences, Jim, because I've had those experiences at least twice. And I've had experiences where I've sat in a room and watched time not only stand still, but actually reverse. Or and reverse and speed up in the same time frame. So we're not talking about things here that it's like, oh, I think that happened. It was like, no, this happened over a long enough period of time that it was palpable. And it's, you know, we could do an entire show on this subject. You know, but you were talking about this, and it's interesting because even in the New Testament, there's the prophecy in the book of Luke, which says, this same Jesus which you saw will come once again in the clouds. And, you know, that's always, especially since this whole cloud thing has kind of occurred, I'm kind of like thinking there's something more about clouds than just these fluffy things in the sky. There's something else. It's probably both a metaphor and it's also perhaps even a storage medium.
I agree. I mean, there is, you know, in the Bible, I can't remember how many times clouds are mentioned.
It's all over the place. Yeah.
There's so many events. You know, Jesus is going to return in the clouds. He left in the clouds.
Yeah.
And I've always said it's all happening in the sky. That's one of my favorite sayings.
It's all there, man.
it's all happening in the sky. And it's mind blowing, you know, and, you know, I'm not thumping on the Bible. Or
no, I'm not either. People know that.
I know. Yeah, you know,
no Bible thumping here. I won't allow.
but you know, if you look at all the prophecies, like 30% of the Bible is prophecy, and it's the only document in history where, so far to date, all the prophecies have been fulfilled 100%.
Yeah.
You know, Nostradamus can't say that. I mean, it's the only one. So for me, you know, I look for a lot of answers there, you know, and also alternate biblical text, you know, like the book of Enoch. And
yes, absolutely.
You know, but, and like you said, this could be I'll stop here because this could be a subject for an entirely different show.
And
but
we may have that conversation.
We may have it.
But, you know, I could go on for hours of events similar to this time thing where it's mind blowing. I mean, it's absolutely mind blowing, you know. But that, you know, we're back to the subject of folk craft.
Yeah. So
where do we want to take this? Time is, as Sean said, 2 hours goes fast. I'm watching the clock go zoom. So let's. Where do we want to hit it?
Well, Sean, if you have something else you want to say about the sky, Sean, let me know. But if not, I just, because, you know, I've enjoyed chatting with both of you guys about a number of topics, and we seem to be living in absolute insanity right now, I would kind of like to get your perspectives on the things going on in the world that aren't in the sky, because you guys have eyes to see something most people can't. What are you seeing in the things that everyone is talking about?
Well, I you know, nowadays I kind of laugh about what's going on on Terra Firma, because what's going on above is so much more interesting
that
anybody can see. And it's been going on for years. And, you know, I walk outside now and it's like looking through the Matrix. It's just, you can see, I can see them just.
You can see it glitch. Yeah. It's like it pixelates
right through it. And it's like, okay. And then you see what's on TV and this is happening here and this is going on. It's like, whatever. Is it connected? It very well could be. But I find it. Y'all still there?
We're here.
We can hear you, Sean.
Okay, it said I got cut off. Essentially, I just get a bigger kick out of what's going on up above than anything that happens in politics and, you know, whatever it may be in the world. But I'd like to go back briefly to what y'all were talking about. There's things in the Bible that are correlating with what we've studied, and I find that extremely interesting. But we can also talk about different cultures in the past who have talked about their gods coming out of the sky, coming out of the clouds.
The Hindu, Vimanas.
There's so much. Yeah. Vimanas, Vedas, all of that. I think it's all connected. I really do.
Yeah. And what about, I mean, have you, I don't know, I think about this sometimes. You know, Randy and I have spent a lot of time talking about quote unquote secret space program and the problem with the secret space program and the multiple problem with the secret space programs. And the longer that these conferences and people talking about it go on, with them not paying any attention to your work, Sean. Like, to me, that is the biggest evidence that there is a problem. Because in my opinion, if there is a secret space program, you have documented more evidence of it than any of the people who are going around telling everybody about it.
So-called whistleblowers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you think, Sean?
Well, I've got some opinions on people like that, and I don't want to be negative, but I'll just say I'm not impressed.
You can be frank.
Yeah,
okay, frank. I'll be frank. Anybody who mentions Roswell or a book about Roswell, you know, forget it. How far are we going to get with that? That was, you know, 70-something years ago. What's going on right now up above everyone is very pertinent, very interesting, and I think we should be talking more about that. But, you know, it's getting there slowly, more slowly than, you know, I'd like or anybody would like, but it's happening. The information cannot be stopped. And whether this interview reaches people or not, people will start seeing these more and more, and they have. And that's the beautiful part about it is putting the information out there and getting contacted by somebody who came across, you know, our work, Jim's work, Elmec, Belfast BAP, anybody. And said, you know, thank you for doing this because we thought we were crazy. And we've been seeing this for years. My family thinks I'm nuts and so on and so forth. Thanks for the help.
It's almost a mark of valor now that your family thinks you're nuts. I mean, that seems to be like a club we're in.
Yeah.
It is, but it's getting there bit by bit.
Yeah,
so on that note, before we do actually run the clock down, Did we have a new video, Sean, that you wanted to show us? Something new?
No, it was just the photographs that I showed you all the other day.
Okay.
From the other day, from 5 days ago. And what I'm getting into now and just how to show them a little bit better. And I've gotten a more positive response by especially doing the inverse technique than the old
method. It is easier to see. And also, Sean, haven't since the last time that you were on, I know it was last time you were on, we spoke about your photograph of the lightning strike. Haven't since that time you confirmed that there was a triangular craft in that photograph?
There's a triangular craft. There's a rod that is 30 feet long. And there's multiple other objects in that photograph that I brushed off as paper flying around. I just didn't know. But now I know a lot more. I can realize that lightning photograph hitting the World Trade Center that I took in
Can you
July.
Throw that? Is there a chance you can throw that up on the screen? Do you have that handy?
Let me see if I can dig it up.
And isn't
that would be a good visual for people who would, because the people see that. I think that's one of your most compelling images personally. I mean, I saw it took my breath away. My memories of the World Trade Center are so, I guess, burned into my brain.
I just knew the first time I saw that, long before you were able to figure that out, I knew that somehow that photograph was connected to you being the person that that discovered these triangular
cuts. That right there.
And y'all serious, see it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Seriously, when I look at that, it does something. I just get.
Yeah. When I first saw that, I knew that it was no mistake that you were the guy who does this spotting of the triangular gun. I don't know how I knew that. Where can you, can you have the image where you can show people where it is?
No, because this is a low res version, but I can tell you up at the top, can you see my cursor?
Yes.
See my little thing? The rod is up here and it's curved and it seems like the bolt is actually coming around it. There's another craft when you zoom in along this side, and that's the triangular one.
Right there, I see it. Yeah.
Okay, and then on this side, before right I essentially airbrushed them out, this whole section over here is little white objects all over the place. So, yeah,
this goes a long way towards something Emily and I have talked about, and it's kind of our common opinion, that whatever else was going on with the World Trade Center, that particular location there, and perhaps the building itself, was some kind of portal system. That, in fact, that's why they can't build another high rise in that location. So, there's wild ass speculation for you.
Yeah,
we talked about this on the last show, and I'm like, portal, where, World Trade Center? I don't know. But when I revisited that photograph and looked at it again, and knowing what I know now, I'm like, boom, 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 there it is. There's something there.
I knew it.
Welcome to our world. It's wild and weird. Guys, we're kind of getting to the end here, and this has been so much fun. I've gotten, you know, kind of a head rush from all of this. Anything else we wanna catch up with here before we back out tonight?
We may have to do another show. I know, because I know.
Oh, I know we're going to. I can tell you right now. I've decreed it.
Yeah.
I've got more video footage and photos, and I know Sean does too.
And I think this is a great medium to bring this stuff out, you know, because.
I agree. Yep.
And Jim, we can have you back to talk about some of these other paranormal anomalies. Yeah,
I'd love to. I mean, I could go on for between my son's experiences. My wife has had some wild experiences. My daughter, myself, you know, since I was, I don't know, 16, 17 years old. I mean, wild stuff. Like, actually, you know, like seeing my father's restaurant and bar burn in a vision the day before it happened. I mean, just wild stuff. I mean, crazy.
Yeah, that's that stuff's up our alley. So, yeah, we'll have to have you back for that. And maybe, you know, we'll do this again with both of you. Maybe sometime we'll also invite Ilana to join us, and we'll just go crazy on the sky.
There you go. We'll put a panel together.
We'll
just rock and roll.
That sounds great.
All right.
Thank you.
All right, guys. Thanks so much for what you presented. Won't be the last time. And
hang on the line for a second when we're done.
Yeah. We're going to back out of here. Again, this is Off Planet Radio. The website is offplanetradio.com. I'm Randy Moggins with Emily Moyer and our guests Jim Kerr and Sean Gautreaux. And we'll be back with another show very soon, because we're loading them up right now. Truth is out there. It's inside you. We'll be right back.